Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all here on this beautiful Sunday morning. I love this time of year because it's a little bit cooler. It's not as hot. I don't know about you, but I don't do well with plus 30 heat. I melt. So I like this kind of weather. It was cooler. It's not too cold. Well, it'll be a nice little bit later. It's supposed to be 16 degrees today, or 15 or 16 degrees today, I guess. So it's going to be a beautiful day. And but any day to worship the Lord is a beautiful day. And so it's wonderful to be able to come together in community to worship our Lord and Savior this morning. We'll get into our prayer time later. We'll be sharing a little bit about, there's a few people who are dealing with health issues and family situations we'll pray for later in our prayer time. But that's why we're few in number this morning. But God's word says, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I will be also. And so we know that God is here with us this morning because there's more than three of us. And so it's good to worship the Lord this morning. Some announcements to make you aware of. First of all, if you're new, we have a cupboard just the side here, and on it is these little visitor cards. So if you're new, if you'd like to fill it out and just put it in that little black box in there as well, it'll give us a record that you came to visit us, and I'll give you a call sometime this week just to follow up on your visit with us. Also, you'll notice during our service time, we don't take up offering. We do that on purpose because, not that we don't think we shouldn't give to the Lord. We do believe that we should give to the Lord. God's word says he loves a cheerful giver and that we are to give to the Lord what we have desired in our hearts to give to him. But it's a high form of worship between us and the Lord. And so we don't take up offering, but we have an offering box on the shelf as well, too. So that's how we handle offering for our church. Good morning. Come on right on in. A couple other things to let you know about, too, is next Sunday is when we're doing our joint services with some of the churches in Parkland County. That's happening in the evening, though, at 6 o'clock. And actually, I have a note here from Pastor Josh, because as you know, with the restrictions that have come in place again, that has changed how we're going to have to handle next Sunday night. And so I'll just read here what he wrote for all of us pastors to share with each of our churches this morning. So, does anyone know where Parkland Baptist is in Stony Plain? A few of you do, some of you don't. I'll make sure that there's a map next Sunday morning then for those who like to join us. Spruce Grove, not Stony Plain. Better get the right town right? Don't want to send you in the wrong direction at all. So here's what Pastor Josh wrote for how this is going to work this next Sunday evening. First, we will follow current AHS measures, but we will not require proof of vaccine status. That has been an important thing of our prayer group as pastors, that we have actually taken a stand. And I'll, at the end of our service this morning, I'd just like to take about 5-10 minutes just to talk about how we're going to handle things going forward because of these lockdowns. But also how that affects us as a church. And that's one of those things, too, that we're not gonna deter anyone from coming. Jesus didn't reject anyone. We're not going to either. And so that's why Pastor Josh put that note in there, to make sure that everyone knows that it doesn't matter if you're vaccinated or not, everyone is welcome to come. Two, due to the 1/3 fire code capacity, we will have 2 services. We originally planned to do 1 service, about 2 hours long, but we've changed it to be 2 services and shorter than 2 hours because that would be a very long night for those of us who are serving. So each service will host a maximum of 95 people. Service will be at 6 o'clock to 7:15, and the second service will be 7:30 to 8:45. Three, because we are hosting 2 services, people will need to register for 1 of the 2 services to ensure numbers remain within the 1/3 capacity. I'll address that later as well. Number 4, to register online, go to parklandbaptist.ca and follow the appropriate links. If you are not able to register online, please contact the church office. And I have the phone number for that here as well. So we all have different views of how to handle this whole situation, but that's the protocols we've had to put in place for this worship gathering next Sunday night. And so we hope that doesn't deter anyone from coming because it'll be a great time of worship between several different churches, and through different denominations as well, too. There's an E-Free Church. There's us. We're, by the way, non-denominational. There's a Charismatic Church. There is two Baptist churches. There's a Free Methodist Church. And there's another church, and I can't remember what denomination they are. And but it's just neat to see how many of us who are of the same mind based of the gospel, who is God, what does the Bible say, we believe the Bible, and to see these different churches come together to worship God, especially in this time too. This is a difficult time for everyone. So I'll talk about that a little bit after the service too. The last thing is just a reminder too that on top, man, it's one of those weeks. On October 9th is when we're having our men's gathering. And so all men, that includes boys, are welcome to join us as men as we join together. We're discussing a book together called Biblical Eldership. What does God's word say? How does eldership, how does leadership look in the church? How's it supposed to function? And so we as men and boys will be discussing this book together. By the way, if you're wondering why we haven't talked about women's ministry, it's because we're talking about that. What is that going to look like? And so that's coming down the road. So we'll be sharing that once we know how that's going to look. That's all the announcements. Oh, there's one more. On our bookshelves as well, there is a prayer calendar. We're putting out a calendar for prayer every month. And it has a list of everyone who's part of our church. So we have a way to remember to pray for everyone throughout the week. And there's other things in here to pray for too. Needs of our church, praying for other churches that we pray for, as well as our community and our nation. And so if you don't have one of these, I invite you to grab one of them on the way out. There's enough of these that every single person, whether you're part of our church or new to our church, for everyone to take one. So don't feel like going, oh, I can't take more than one. No, if there's five in your household, you're welcome to take five of them. So that's just one note to let you know about too. This Wednesday, speaking of prayer being important, this Wednesday we'll meet here in this room for prayer. So anyone who wants to join us for prayer, we spend time praying for our community, for each other, and the things that God puts on our hearts to pray for. So everyone is welcome to come, regardless of age as well, to come and join us in prayer. That starts at 7 o'clock, and we go for about an hour to an hour and 15 minutes for prayer. Speaking of prayer, let's go to the Lord and invite him to meet with us this morning. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for this time we have now to worship you in spirit and in truth. God, you are a good and wonderful God. And we're so thankful that we can come freely to worship you. So Lord God, we ask you to meet with us as we've come to meet with you. For these things we pray in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Part of our time of worship together is we've spent time partaking in another communion table together as well. And normally we'd be passing the plate out, but just for this Sunday and maybe going forward, we're going to have everyone welcome to come up to the table here in households to partake. And by the way, even if people come up to take up, or if you feel like, no, I can't partake for whatever reason, then don't worry about it. This is not a place of judgment. This is a place of remember what Christ has done for us. And so also, you don't need to be a member of our church to partake of this table this morning. All you need to be is one who has made a confession of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord, that you've confessed your sins to him. In other words, that you're a Christian. So you're welcome to partake of this table with this morning. But God's word tells us to prepare before we partake of this table together too, to examine ourselves to make sure we're right before the Lord, so that we don't take the table of the Lord for granted or lightly. So the Apostle Paul gives us these instructions in 1 Corinthians 11. Whoever eats of the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and in so doing, he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks eats and drinks judgment to himself, if he does not judge the body rightly. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep. But if we judge ourselves rightly, we would not be judged. This instruction then is to examine ourselves. And so let's now take a moment of silent prayer to confess our sins to the Lord. And if we can't think of any sins, ask the Lord too, Lord, is there anything I've committed that I don't realize or recognize that I have committed? And then confess that to the Lord. Let's take a moment of silent prayer together. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much that you forgive us our sins. That as you say in 1 John 1:9, that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord God, you're an amazing God. A God is who is holy, but a God of love too. So, Lord Jesus, we thank you for your sacrifice on the cross for our sins, to save us from our sins, and to make us pure and holy and righteous. God, you are a good God. Amen. As I mentioned, as we partake of this table, that as you feel led as a household to come and partake of the table, and we're going to do it a little bit differently than we normally have done with this table, actually. At any time in the service that you feel time to go up to partake of the table, you're welcome to come. So for singing songs and you feel led at that time to go, feel free to. If it's during the children's moment, feel free to do so. I only ask not during the sermon time, if at all possible. But as the Lord leads, I'll still leave a moment or two for households to come up and partake. And after a few moments, we'll continue to resume our service. So again, as the Lord leads. The bread, I'm going to lift the lid here, the bread and the cup is there. And feel free, Bella, you can grab the garbage can. Sorry, I forgot to put the garbage can beside there beforehand. The cups are disposable, so just feel free to drop it in the garbage can after you've partaken. For I receive from the Lord that which I also deliver to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Brother Keith, would you give thanks to the Lord for his blood shed for us and for his body?
Moment in that particular
as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. Praise be to God. I failed to mention this, I should have, that even if you feel uncomfortable with coming up during the service at any time, that the table will still be available here for after the service. So if you're like some of us, where if you weren't gone up with a family and you feel like, I don't want to go up in front, this will be still available once our service is concluded as well, too. We want everyone to be able to partake of the table who feels that they're able to because of their relationship with Jesus Christ. It is good to sing praises to our Lord, too. And so I'm going to invite Keith to come and lead us now in song as we sing praises to our Lord this morning.
Good morning, everybody. Well, we tend to sing a mix of contemporary choruses and songs, as well as hymnal hymns, older hymns, in this congregation. And today's one of those days where we're going to dip into the hymnal a little bit, and maybe start with a few of the some of the older hymns. But please, this is a time of worship, and as I was pulling this worship service together this week, I thought, you know, this is really just about letting God know how much we love him. Christ, how much we love you. And so all of these songs, whether they're older or contemporary, are all focused on just letting God know how much we love him. If you want to stand and sing, please do. If you want to sit and sing, please do. If you want, we have some dancers here too, from time to time. So if you need to dance to express yourself, you go right ahead.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and to just to rest upon his promise and to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how trust him more. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior. How Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. My Jesus, I love thee, I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless deep, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus,
amen.
Amen.
You want to keep going?
Yeah.
Okay.
Altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came, altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful. sin upon that cross, and I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship.
Thank you. Please be seated. Please be seated. God is good, right?
Yes.
All the time.
Thank you, Keith and Sherry, for leading us in worship this morning. We also have a time in our worship where we have a time to testify. It's kind of a testimonial time where we have a chance to share what has God been doing in our lives in this past week. How has he been good to us? Or what has he taught us this past week? And so Keith is going to lead that for us in this time now. Thank you, Keith.
Well, I'm totally jazzed this morning because I have a testimony here. We have been praying for my son Peter, and Mark and others in our prayer group on Wednesday night have just had such a burden for him without ever having met him. And so I got a call last night from my daughter saying, I just got off the phone with Peter, and we've been talking about salvation, and we prayed together. By the time we were done, we were crying, and he said, God is good. He hung up the phone saying, God is good. So thank you for the prayers of this. God is answering prayer in this community here and in this group here. It's happening. And he's not the first to come to the Lord. We've seen Christopher come to the Lord, Millie and Terry's son. God is answering prayer here. So come Wednesday night. It's fun, but God is answering prayer. Praise God. Okay, sorry for being emotional, but it's close to my heart. Close to my heart. And we've been praying for him for years. Years. And it's nice to see him coming into the kingdom here. Who else? Anybody else have something they might like to share about how God's moving in your life this week? Tough times, good times, praise items, prayer requests. We'd love to hear your testimony.
I've been trying to lose weight for a long time. And I haven't done my exercises so faithfully. I started, then I quit, then I start, then I quit. But I'm trying to give up sugar as well. And this morning I stepped on the scale after just starting for about a month and a half, not fully exercising, just doing other small things, moving a little bit more, cutting down on my sugar. I've lost, get this, 8 pounds. God is good. And I seen the ad in the in the bulletin about this church, and I phoned the pastor and he returned my call, and I'm here today thanks to him. Thank you all.
There's a sidebar to that story. I found out this morning, Marlene lives two doors down from me in our subdivision. I've met her husband Don. He's been out cutting the lawn, and my wife Dolly and I have walked past him and said hi, and he said, "Yeah, my wife's name's Darlene, but we've never met Marlene. Sorry, Marlene." And this lady walked in the door this morning. She said, "Hi, I'm Marlene." And all of a sudden, we realized we live two doors from each other. That's wonderful. That's something from God. That's something from God. So we're going to have to talk more. Anybody else? We've seen Peter come. We've seen Christopher come. Jonathan's next. Can we believe that? Let's believe that. Thanks, Donna. Anyone else? Thank you. And, you know, I've just been so impressed with Mark and his family because they had such a burden for Peter without ever having met with him. And we met at Mark's house through the summer while Kevin was away on vacation. And they didn't forget him. They kept bringing him up, you know, and said, we've got to pray for Peter. And that's really moving when you have people who have never met your family say, I'll stand in the gap and pray for him. And then to have this answer to prayer. Praise God. So thank you. Thank you to you and your family. Please tell your dad and your brother, especially your brother who always ends prayer time with us with God is good. He looks at Kevin and says, God is good. Well, guess what? Peter said that last night. God is good. Anyone else? All right. Thanks, Pastor.
Thank you, Keith. I should just let this up because Mark's going to lead us in prayer in just a moment here, so I should just leave it up for him, too. I feel like I'm a short man among giants. My son's tall, too. So, but thank you all for sharing. Marlene, you're brave to come right up to the mic, too. Thank you for sharing with us this morning, too. And it's wonderful to hear of God's work among us and in our community, too. And Keith, I had tears in my eyes, too, hearing you share about Peter. And when you first mentioned Peter, I'm going, did he receive Christ? And so it's wonderful to hear that. Thank you for sharing with us this morning. It's, you know, one of the things that excite me the most is when I hear someone come to faith. I don't know if you've ever led someone to the Lord, but I find it's exciting when someone comes to faith. Another thing that really excites me is when someone gets baptized, too. But to see God at work, see God use us, even in spite of us sometimes. There's been many times I share the gospel and I'm going, Lord, how could you have used that today? And I find later out that the person comes to faith, maybe not in that moment, but maybe later too. And so it's always exciting to see people come into faith in Jesus Christ. And so we'll continue to pray for Peter too, that now he finds a good Bible-believing church that will disciple him in his newfound faith. And as we pray that for Christopher too, as we understand he's come to faith, there are some things that when Sharon and I and the kids went to visit Terry Milley a couple weeks ago, he came out, for those who weren't here last Sunday, he came out with this devotional book that he's been reading and photocopied several pages and said, would you take a look at this? Maybe you could use this for your men's prayer time, your men's group. And so we talked about some things and realized, okay, well, it's great he's coming to the kingdom, but there's some things we need to disciple him in to understand and know for the truth of who God is and how we're to live as Christians. And so just because someone comes to faith doesn't mean you stop praying for them. So let's continue to pray for Peter, continue to pray for Christopher. And so we're going to go to our time of prayer and invite Mark to come and lead us in prayer. As he's coming up, just a couple things for us to be mindful of. I got a text from Millie this morning. They were up and ready to come for worship this morning, but Terry is in a lot of pain, and so they decided that they just need to stay home today. For those who weren't here on Wednesday night, Terry and Millie got some hard news. Terry went for some tests, and his test came back for colon cancer. And so we need to pray for him, and he's been in a lot of pain. That's why they're off and on these last number of Sundays, because a lot of times he's in pain and isn't able to come because of that. So, and from what I understood, they were excited to come because of our fellowship time after, but he's dealing with a lot of pain. So let's pray for him this morning. And Marlene, it's okay if we pray for your husband this morning too, since you mentioned it earlier.
Yes.
All right. So Marlene's husband's name is Don, and so he is one of those people we need to be praying for too, for salvation. So if we can pray for those things. And so Mark, come up and lead us in prayer.
Well, it's such encouraging news to hear about Peter, and we're just so grateful, Keith, and that's such a lift to hear that. And we, you know, God is good and God loves us, and it's just so good to serve a God who cares, who loves us, who's concerned for us, and who never lets go of us. And I'm just so grateful. It's so encouraging to hear that news, and I just, you know, just share God's blessing to you and your family. You've been a blessing to us, Keith, and it's just so wonderful to see this, and I'm just so grateful for what happened. And I would just encourage you, Donna, for your son, and we'll just continue to uphold him. And it's just so good to trust our God. Let's go to prayer now. Dear Lord, we just thank you today for being with us and for providing for us in so many ways. And we just thank you, Lord, for our salvation. We thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for loving us and caring for us. And we thank you, Lord, for just how you seek us out. We don't perseek you, but you find us and you seek us and you initiate the contact because you love us. And we thank you, Lord, that for God so loved the world that he sent his only son. And oh, without that, we would be lost. We would have no hope. And we just thank you and we praise you, Lord God, that you love us and you never let go of us. And you pursue us all the way. And you offer us eternal life and a relationship with you. Oh, we just thank you and we praise you, oh God, for your love, for your mercy, for your grace, for giving us what we could never earn, what we do not deserve. Oh, Lord, we just thank you and praise you for this. And we worship you today. And we just thank you, Lord, that we can come together with our brothers and sisters and we can share one another's burdens and we can lift one another up. And oh Lord, it's a privilege to be able to pray for our brothers and sisters. We thank you so much for Peter and for the time that we prayed for Peter. And we just thank you, Lord, that Peter has come to faith in Christ. And we just praise you for this. We just praise you for this, oh God. This is such wonderful news. And we just thank you and praise you. It's all we can say. We kneel down in humility before you and say, oh God, we worship you. We're in awe of what you can do. We just praise you and we're in awe of you today. And oh Lord, we just are just overwhelmed with joy, Lord. And we just thank you and praise you for this. And we ask that Peter will find a good church, that he will grow in his faith. And we just pray for this young man. It'll be such a wonderful privilege to meet him. And I'm so glad that I'll be able to meet him in heaven. And we just thank you and praise you, Lord, for this news. We thank you, Lord, for new people in our midst, Lord. And we thank you for Don and Marlene. And we just ask that Don's spiritual eyes and ears are opened. And we thank you for Marlene's achievement in losing weight. And that's so important to have good health. And we just ask that you bless her. We pray, Lord, for Donna. And we just ask for your hand of healing upon her. We pray for Sam. And we just ask that you be with her and strengthen her. And bless little Jasper and open his spiritual eyes, Lord. And we pray for Donna's son, John, that you will open his spiritual eyes as well, Lord. That you will open his spiritual understanding and draw him to you, O God. We just ask for this, for John. And we thank you for Christopher, Lord, that he's come to faith in Christ. And we ask that he will find a place where he can get discipled, whether it's here or whether it's somewhere else. We just ask, Lord, that you lead Christopher to the right church and the right place where he can find friends and encouragement and where he can be discipled and have someone to mentor him and encourage him. And we ask for Terry and Millie in this difficult time, Lord. It's so hard, colon cancer, it's so painful. And oh, we just ask that your grace and peace be with Terry right now. That you just touch Terry and that he feel your presence and your love. And whether you choose to heal him or whatever happens, only you know, Lord, and you are sovereign, and we recognize your sovereignty. But we just ask that your presence be with Terry. That Terry just feel your presence and your grace and your peace. That you be with him in the midst of his difficulty. You tell us that you don't take away our difficulty, but you are there in the midst of us, the midst of it with us. When we pass through the water, we will not drown. When we pass through the fire, we will not be burnt. We do have to pass through the water, and we do have to pass through the fire, but you are there in the midst of it with us, and you never leave us. Oh God, may Terry just be aware of this today. May he sense your presence and your peace. May he feel your love. Oh God, reach out to Terry today, right now, and just put your arms around him and help him to revel in your love, to know that you are real, that his God is there for him. His God is with him in the midst of this. Oh Lord, just be with Terry and Millie and just strengthen them and encourage them. Oh Lord, be with them today and be with them in this difficult time. And Lord, we just thank you that you love us. We have a lot of challenges with COVID and the restrictions coming again and the vaccine passports and all these things. We just ask you for your wisdom. We ask you for your grace. We ask you for strength and energy. I know I'm finding these vaccine passports challenging, and I just ask you, Lord, that we can work all this out, that we can get these vaccine passports, and we just pray for all of that it works out, Lord. And we just ask for your wisdom and your guidance and your provision. We ask for your wisdom in knowing how to conduct this church and what to do with COVID restrictions and everything that's coming up. We just ask for wisdom for Pastor Kevin and for the leadership of this church, that we will know what you want us to do. Oh Lord, give us your wisdom and your guidance. Show us what we are to do, oh Lord. We just thank you, Lord, for bringing new people again, which is so wonderful to have new faces here today. And we just worship you and we thank you. We ask that you will bless the remainder of our worship, and we ask that you will really anoint Pastor Kevin as he comes to preach to us today, that you will give him your anointing, your words, your message to us, and that you will use him and speak through him, and that the Holy Spirit will just be so powerful in his words to us today, that we will just sense your presence, and we will sense your leading and your guidance. Just bless and strengthen the Henrys. Give them wisdom and guidance as well, O Lord. And we just praise you for who you are. We praise you. We thank you. We love you. We worship you. We thank you and honor you for our salvation. And we just ask that you be with us today and bless our little barbecue time afterwards, Lord, if that's still on. Just bless that and bless our time of fellowship with one another after. In the name of our wonderful and glorious Savior, amen.
Again, I'd like to welcome you to worship however you feel comfortable, standing or sitting or however. And we have a couple of more verses to sing here.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how
how great the pain of searing
ashamed, I hear my mocking voice. The scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, nor wisdom. But I will boast in resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Please be seated.
Thank you, Keith, for leading us in worship this morning. Wonderful choice of songs this morning, and thanks again to my wife for playing this morning as well, too. I also want to give thanks to my daughter and my son. My daughter Arielle's running PowerPoint this morning. It's actually her first time and is doing a wonderful job, so thank you, Arielle. Caleb normally runs it, and I'm so thankful for him running it. He has some great knowledge with technology, and so thankful that he's been able to run it and helping his son, helping his sister. Oh my goodness. Like I said, it's been one of those weeks. It's wonderful that Caleb was able to help his sister learn how to run this morning too. A while ago, we've been praying that someone would send someone else to help run PowerPoint because my son was doing it every week. And other than when Keith would lead worship, well, then I would be running it then. And so we were praying that, Lord, would you bring someone else? And about a month ago, Ariel said, I'd be willing to help out. So thank you, Arielle, and to Caleb, too, for doing that for us. We appreciate that. And so it doesn't mean we won't pray for more people to help out in these ways. We're always thankful when God brings someone to be part of community with us and sharing in their gifts and abilities and their talents and spiritual gifts and serving together in the work God has called us together to do. We have a children's moment this morning. Normally, we only do this every couple of weeks. But decided this week that I would do a children's moment anyway still. We had thought that Sam and Jasper were going to be here, but unfortunately Sam and Jasper are still ill. I had been communicating with her this week, and Donna mentioned this morning when she came in too that Sam is still sick. And so fortunately it's just a cold, but you know how colds are, right? You feel like you've died sometimes when you've had colds, depending on how the severity of them. But so they are home getting better. So we're thankful that they're resting, and we'll pray that they continue to get better as well, too. But as you know, too, that yesterday was canceled. The Onaway Heritage Center here had planned their fall half festival, which they had asked me to do rope tricks. And I had planned to do some tricks and use one to share the gospel. But unfortunately, that got canceled. And so I thought, well, I'll share a trick this morning. And actually, this morning we're talking about evangelism as we start a new series. I have to apologize. I lied last week, and I got ahead of myself. I said we're going to talk about Starting this Sunday, we're going to start talking about our core values as a church. What does God's Word say about the core values that we have as a church? And I misspoke. I forgot that we're doing a series on our vision first. So these 5 weeks, we're talking about the vision of our church, about five keys to what God has called the church to do, and then we'll start our series on core values. And if those of you who are the first time here, if you don't know what our core values are, they're actually on our banner here on the side of the wall: grace, freedom, love, service, and truth. And so we'll be looking at that starting 5 weeks from now. But today we're starting our series on our vision statement. What is our vision as a church? What has God called us to do together? And today we're talking about evangelism, the first key being evangelism. Some of you know that I have this hobby of doing tricks, and I love sharing the gospel using tricks, because oftentimes, especially with kids, it kind of gathers their attention a little bit, doesn't it? Yes? No? Yes? No kids want to see tricks, do you? No one's shaking their head, no. Okay, so I guess you guys do just want to see this. So I'm going to use this in a means to share the gospel. I know all of you have heard it before, but this is an example of that you can use different gifts and abilities that you have to share the gospel. I have a friend, he's actually lives in the Philippines now, and before he left to the Philippines, he gave me this little church building a friend of his had made, and had scripture verses all over it, and inside of it is an envelope with the gospel message inside of it. And so this gentleman, this friend of my friend's, made this little tool to share the gospel. So you too can use the gift and abilities God has given you to share his good news. So I have a long rope here. This is going to represent us. It's white. And when we're first born, we're not white. We kind of say that God's word says that our sins are red as crimson, red as scarlet. Why is that? Because sin is an awful thing. God intends us to be like this rope, to be white, to be pure, to be holy. But there's a problem with us as people. There's something that we have called sin. And went a little too far here. We have something called sin. What does sin do to us? Does anyone know? Sin separates us from God, right? It's what causes us to, in a way, we're not good people because of our sin. As well, we know God makes us good, though, because of his sacrifice. So sin means that we're separated from God. That means our relationship with God is broken. That means that we are broken. My thumb's too big for those scissors. So we're broken. What do? To get things back together again? You can't, right? Oh, repent. Yes. Yes. On our own, we can't do anything on our own to be saved, to be put back together. But like Marlene said, is to repent. What is repentance? A 180, yeah. The term repentance means to change our minds, to change how we think. And part of that, then, how we change how we think should influence our actions, should change how we believe, also even how we feel about things. So we repent. We say, Lord God, forgive me of my sins. God's word tells us that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So it's coming to Jesus, repenting, confessing our sins, placing our faith in him. And when we do that, something takes place. God's word tells us that he saves us from our sins, that he gives us new life. And he then again makes us whole again. Wow. So God forgives us. He makes us whole again to make us one whole piece again. It's a wonderful thing to know that Jesus loves us that much, that he would die in our place for our sins, so we don't have to face an eternity in hell, but have eternity with Jesus in heaven, to have eternal peace, to have eternal comfort. God is good. All the time, God is good. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for your gift of salvation, for your sacrifice upon the cross for our sins. Lord God, we thank you. There's not enough words in this world, in our language, or all the languages put together to express how thankful that we are and how wonderful that you are because of your great love for us. Lord, we have sung about your great love this morning in these songs too, and the great reward that you've given us because of your gift of salvation. Lord, we pray for these children. Lord, we think of Jasper too, who isn't here this morning, but for all of our children, whether they be teenagers or little children, Lord, we thank you for them. We pray, Lord God, that they would grow up in your ways, Lord, and for those children who do not yet know you, Lord, we pray that they come to faith soon. Lord, use us as parents, use our church to influence these children to come to faith in you. Give us the wisdom then, too, to disciple them in your ways, Lord God. Give us as parents your wisdom, your understanding, to train our children in the ways they're to go in you. Give us wisdom as a church, Lord, to come alongside of our families, to encourage the parents as we raise our children, but to also be an example to our children as a whole. God, you are good. We thank you, Lord God, and praise you. Amen. I invite you to take your Bibles in hand and turn with me to Mark chapter 16. To Mark chapter 16, and we'll be reading from verse 14 to 20. We actually had planned for Sam to read for us this morning, but as we mentioned, she's not well. So again, it's a reminder for us to pray for her and Jasper to be better. Mark chapter 16, verse 14. Through 20. Afterward, he appeared to the 11 themselves as they were reclining at the table, and he reproached them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they had not believed those who had seen him after he had risen. And he said to them, "Go into the world and preach the gospel to all creation. And he who has believed and has been baptized shall be saved. And he who has disbelieved shall be condemned. These signs will accompany those who have believed. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will pick up serpents. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover." So then, when the Lord Jesus had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere, while the Lord worked with them and confirmed the word by the signs that followed. And they promptly reported all these instructions to Peter and his companions. And after that, Jesus himself sent out through them from east to west the sacred and imperishable proclamation of eternal salvation. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for these words, these reminders of some of the last words you gave your disciples before you ascended to heaven. The charge and the command to go and make more disciples. Lord Jesus, as we study these words now, Lord, may you guide us. May you teach us this morning through your word. We ask you, Lord God, to open our eyes to see you, to open our ears to hear from you, and to give us the courage to put into practice what you teach us this morning. For these things we pray in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. As I mentioned, today we begin a new series on evangelism. We're talking about evangelism today, but our series is on our vision statement. And our vision statement says this, that New Life Christian Community exists to bring honor and glory to God by evangelizing the lost, discipling the brethren, praying in the spirit. Oh man, I should know this off by heart. Praying in corporate unity and fellowshipping together. Oh, worship was part of that too. Worshiping in spirit and in truth. Man, I should know this already, shouldn't I? We've had this statement for a little under 2 years now, and you'd think the pastor would know the statement, especially if he's preaching on it. Anyway, that's our vision statement. We believe that as in the very beginning of us as a church, we prayed and asked, Lord, what is it what you've called us to do? And so we started to study God's word. What would we have us do? And so these five things we'll be looking at these next 5 weeks are the five things that God has called us to do. I call them five keys of ministry of the church, something that all of us as a church are called to do individually and together. And today, again, we're talking about evangelism. It's important for us to understand the call to evangelism. The call for us as individuals, but just as importantly for us together as the church. There's an evangelist named Leighton Ford. And he tells a story of one time when he was in Nova Scotia. He had a crusade going on one night, and he had proclaimed the gospel and shared the gospel to those. And there was a person in the crowd, a well-known evangelist named Billy Graham. And he was actually going to be speaking the next night. Actually, Leighton Ford and Billy Graham were good friends. And so Billy Graham actually shared this part of the story to Leighton Ford later, but Billy Graham was sitting in the seat, and he kind of disguised himself for that night because he didn't want anyone to recognize him, so he had a ball cap on and glasses. Must have been like Clark Kent, maybe. I don't know how people do that. Anyway, so Billy Graham recognized and saw the person in front of him. It seemed that this person was stirred by the gospel message. And so Billy Graham tapped him on the shoulder during the altar call and said, hey, would you like to go up? I'll be willing to go up with you and to pray with you to receive forgiveness of your sins. The man sat there and paused for a moment and said, nah, I'll wait till the big gun comes out tomorrow night. Well, sometimes it feels that way with evangelism. Sometimes we think, well, we'll wait for the big guns to come out and share the gospel. We're small shots, and so we'll leave it to the big guns. Well, that's not what God intended for us as the church. God has called all of us in the church to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, I haven't written down my notes here. I should have been able to look at my notes because I was trying to do from memory the statement of faith or our purpose statement. I have it written down in my notes here. So I'll repeat it for you again then. The purpose of New Life Christian Community is to bring glory to God by evangelizing the lost, discipling the body, praying in corporate unity, worshiping God in spirit and truth, and fellowshipping together in biblical community. We also have a slogan that goes along with that, which says, every disciple, a disciple maker. Which fits well with evangelism, doesn't it? We're all called to make disciples. And evangelism is a part of that. We also have a theme verse for us as a church, and it's 1 Peter 3, verse 8, which says, finally, all of you have unity of mind. Oh man, that's a good one and very important, but sometimes hard, isn't it? Have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. This still relates to evangelism too, in how we approach those who are lost, and how we share the gospel. We're supposed to be of one mind in the gospel together, to proclaim the gospel in one mind together. We're supposed to show love to each other. You know that the world looks at Christians And they look at us at how do we treat each other. I have heard some non-Christians say that, you know what, I don't want to be a Christian because sometimes you Christians don't treat each other very nicely at all. Which is a sad mark on the church, isn't it? Even between churches. How do we treat other churches? Those churches that are truly our brothers and sisters in Christ. A tender heart. Having a tender heart for people. Where they're at. It's wonderful to hear, Keith, of how your son has come to faith. Like you mentioned, we've been praying for Peter for some time now. As long as I've known you, Keith, you've brought up Peter, and we've been praying for him ever since. And now to see him come to faith, praying for him, we've had a tender heart for Peter. We've had a tender heart for Christopher. We have a tender heart for Jonathan, for all those who are lost, to have a tender heart for them. We hear this morning, too, Marlene's husband, Don. We all have people that we know who aren't Christians. It may be our neighbors. It may be friends. Maybe other family members. We need to have a tender heart for them, as we need to have a tender heart for each other, too. And a humble mind. You know, we're to have humble minds, too. That doesn't mean that we think badly of ourselves, but just realize our true state of who we are, our limitations, our strengths, and how God can use each one of us. God can use all of us in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. In our passage this morning, these are some of the final words that Jesus gives his disciples before he returns to heaven to go and prepare a place for us. And even though we know this, though, about Jesus, even though we went home to heaven to prepare a place for us, he's still with us because he is God. And so God is everywhere at all times. So he is here with us now too still. But in our passage again, he appears to the disciples again one more time. But what does he say in verse 14? Afterward, he appeared to the 11 themselves as they were reclining at the table. And he approached them for their unbelief. Isn't that hard to believe? Here, these disciples, some of them had seen Jesus risen, but it seemed like it was too good to be true in some way. So some of them had unbelief still. Then there was those who didn't hear, like doubting Thomas, who hadn't seen Jesus. We see in other passages that he finally sees Jesus and then believes. But there are some who had unbelief still. And Jesus rebukes them for it. Again, he approached them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they had not believed those who had seen him after he had risen. So there's a little bit of the background here of this story a bit. Jesus is a little bit upset with his disciples, some of them, because they weren't believing. But then he gives them some instructions and teaches them again. He begins to teach them that now, because they were his disciples, because of the good news of the gospel now, what he has done on the cross for them, to go out now likewise and share the gospel. There's a whole list here now, too, of signs that would follow them as disciples. Some kind of weird things, isn't there? Like you'd be able to drink poison and not die, that you can handle serpents and not be bit. I think God has given us good brains to use. And I think what Jesus is saying with those things is that God will protect us. I don't think Jesus is saying to his disciples, now go grab a vial of poison and drink it. Go and handle a cobra, king cobra, and play with them. I don't think God's saying that at all. But merely that he is going to protect us as we go out and share the gospel. Now, it doesn't mean we're going to face hardship sometimes. It doesn't mean we're going to face hard people as we share the gospel sometimes. But God will still protect us through those gospel sharing times that may be difficult sometimes. I've found, actually, in Canada, it's a little bit different, I find. I've shared the gospel many times on the beach in Alberta Beach. I've knocked on every door in town here a few times. And the worst I've ever seen so far is someone saying, I don't want to hear it, and close their door. That's actually pretty good for Canada. But in other countries, they have it far worse. Some are killed for sharing the gospel. But regardless, we are called to share the gospel. There's two keys to evangelism that we want to share by looking at this passage this morning. The first is this, is to go into the world. To go into the world. Verse 15, we read these words. And he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. To go into all the world and to preach the gospel to all creation. The word go is an important word here. It's a verb. It's an action word. It means that you need to do something. The Greek word for go here is poreomai, which means to move over an area from a point of departure or destination. So it means to move somewhere. So like when you came in this morning in the door, you had to move from the door to your seat. So you went. You had to go to your seat. But there's more to this definition of go than just the movement that we do. It also means to conduct oneself, how we live and walk. It's very interesting, isn't it? So when Jesus is telling his disciples to go, he's not only telling them to move, but it's in some ways in how we act and live too, isn't it? I said earlier, the world is watching us. The world is watching our actions. So our actions should show for what we believe. The third part of this definition for this Greek word of go is to go to one's death. Now that may be a little more scary, it is, isn't it? But again, this still has deep importance to this word go. Meaning we must be willing to go and share the gospel at no matter the cost. Might be scary sometimes. Not always, but sometimes it can be scary. But if we love Jesus because of what he has done for us, we must go to share the gospel. I often say to people that, you know what, it's important for me to study God's word, to be in prayer, to grow my relationship with God, because as I love God more, I love people more. It reminds me then that I must be willing to go no matter the cost. I used to run a podcast. There we go. That's the term I'm looking for. And I would always sign off the podcast by saying to go and preach the gospel to anyone, anywhere, and at no matter the cost. We must go and share the gospel. And as Jesus even says, to all of creation. Well, how does that make sense? You mean I'm supposed to go and share the gospel to the bird on my fence? Or the grass in my yard? Does it mean that we preach the gospel to those things? If need be. It sounds weird, but we are to preach to all of creation, specifically people, absolutely people. But it's okay to preach the gospel to all creation too. It's good practice. I've often done a seminar on evangelism, and a part of it has always been about practicing sharing the gospel. It helps take away the fear a little bit when we share the gospel with people who are lost, when we practice it with other Christians. So I give that as encouragement to us this morning too. Practice sharing the gospel with each other, and even sharing the gospel to creation. It doesn't mean that creation's going to be saved. That God does that work in a different way. But all of humanity needs to hear the gospel. That's why in Romans 10, it tells us that how are they to hear if someone is not sent? How are they to hear if someone doesn't preach? We are to do that, to go and preach the gospel. There's a statement that really actually gets under my skin. It's been attributed to St. Francis of Assisi. The proof actually shows he never said this. But the saying goes this way. It says, preach the gospel, and if necessary, use words. If necessary? Of course it's necessary to use the words of the gospel. How are they going to hear otherwise? And it's not just a matter of us doing good works and kind works. Those are good things to cultivate the person to be ready to hear the gospel. But as we do those kind things, share the gospel. On this statement on evangelism, our purpose statement, we also have a statement about evangelism, and it says this. To evangelize the lost, we will use both invitational and turf events. We will have at least one evangelistic event every month. We will also seek a variety of ways and programs to reach our community with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have done that from the beginning as a church. It's important for us to continue to do that. We have done things called invitational events where we've invited people to come. We've had a seminar called Peace with God, Getting Right with God. And recently, last month, we used one called Hope in Troubled Times. So we've had times where we've invited people to come and hear the gospel. Keith is the one who developed Peace with God and Getting Right with God. And I remember the first time we led it. Actually, Keith led it, but the little group that we were all joined together, and unfortunately, there was only one person from the community, but yet it was one person who came and heard the gospel. And I remember Keith saying after we were done, we were packing up, and Keith said to me, you know, this is the way to do evangelism, doing it together as the church. He's right. It's important for us to do things together as a church, to invite people to different outreaches we do, but also to do what I call turf events. That means we go to where people's turf are. We go on where they are at. It means maybe going to their home, maybe to their workplace. Whatever context people are in, going to them. After all, that's the way Jesus reached people, isn't it? He didn't wait for them. He went to people. There's an old movie I remember watching. I can't remember if it was the 80s or early 90s. A movie called Field of Dreams. Do any of you remember that movie? Kevin Costner plays this guy, and he hears this voice. It says, if you build it, he will come. And through this whole movie, it's about turning his cornfield into a baseball field. And then this whole group of ghost baseball players from the past come out to this field to play. If you build it, he will come. Well, that's not the way God intended us to do evangelism. We can do invitational things where we invite people to come, but God expects us to get on people's turf too, to get into the lives of those who are lost. It's not, if you build it, they will come. No, go to them. Reach them with the gospel message. Some people think and say, though, that, well, it's not my job as a Christian to do it. I've actually heard some Christians say this. Pastor, it's your job to do the evangelizing. Well, yes, that's partially true. It is my job as, not just as a pastor, but as a Christian, to share the gospel with those who are lost and to be an example to the rest of the church in that regard. But God has called every one of us to reach the gospel. So, A, you have the call. It's not just the pastor. You have the call. In Matthew 28:19, Jesus says these words. You probably know these words really well already. But this, again, the final words Jesus says to his disciples before he ascends to heaven. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations. Jesus didn't stop there, obviously. But some people say sometimes that, well, that's a command then to those disciples that were before Jesus. Let's continue on, though, with the words. Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. What were the first disciples and apostles called to do? To go and make disciples and to teach them to observe all that Jesus has commanded. What did Jesus command here? To go and make disciples. Teaching them to do the same thing. So we are also called, all of us are called, to make disciples, to go and reach the lost with the gospel. I'll finish up the last few words of Matthew 28, 19 here, too, because they're still important. It's a reminder that Jesus is with us as we do. And he says, "And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." This actually, this verse, part of the verse actually leads to this next part. You have the power from the Holy Spirit. Jesus says, "Lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age." Jesus is always with us. So we go out to share the gospel, we don't have to worry then too. Because Jesus also said he would give us his Spirit. So he has given us the Holy Spirit to equip us. Yes, it's important for us to be taught and trained in how to share the gospel. But also, more importantly, to rely on the Holy Spirit's power within us to share the gospel. Acts 1 verse 8 says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria. And even to the remotest part of the earth." Yes, these are words that Jesus says to his disciples, but are true for us still too as the church. Jesus has given his Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to us to equip us in the work God has called us to do. So we can go out in the Holy Spirit's power to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. So again, firstly, Jesus tells us to go into the world. That's the first key of evangelism for us as the church. The second key then is this, to preach the gospel. To preach the gospel. I've already alluded to this already when I mentioned the statement that was attributed to St. Francis of Assisi. But again, a reminder for us that we are to preach the gospel. One might think, though, what that term preach, but isn't that the preacher's job to preach? No, did you actually know that the term preach only means to make an announcement? The word preach that Jesus uses here in verse 15, and again verse 15 says, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." Preach the gospel. The Greek word here is a Greek word, kyrisos, which means to make an official announcement. It also means to make a public declaration, to proclaim aloud something. So all preaching is to proclaim something, to speak something. In this case, it's the gospel. So when you share the gospel with someone, you are preaching the gospel because you're announcing something, something of importance, something about someone's eternal, what their eternal destiny could be if they turn to Christ. So we're to go into all creation and preach the gospel. I remember one time I was actually pastoring the Alliance Church in Alberta Beach at the time, and God had led me to preach the gospel often at the beach. And I remember one specific time, this is back when Alberta Beach had their long pier. I don't know if you know about Alberta Beach. They used to have this pier that went out from the beach part that you could walk along it and walk out to the edge and enjoy the scenery of the lake. Well, this one time, it was a Friday afternoon, and God had spoken to me to go and share the gospel that day to the beach, and so I went there, and I started walking on the pier, and I was asking, "Lord, who is it you want me to share the gospel with today?" Got to the end, and nothing in my spirit really resounded that I was supposed to share with any particular person. Till I turned around and walked back towards the shore, and I saw these two teenagers walking, a brother and a sister. And I sense God saying to me, them. As I sometimes do when I'm about to share the gospel, I kind of size the person up. How might they receive? It's probably a bad thing to do, isn't it? Sizing them up. Which of these two are going to be open to the gospel? And I thought, it's going to be the sister. It's got to be the sister. Get up to them. They say hi. They say hi back. And I asked them if I could share something with them. So I begin to share the gospel with them. And halfway through sharing the gospel, all of a sudden the sister walks by me and continues walking, leaving her brother there still. But I continue sharing the gospel with the brother. And I'm like, Lord, I thought it was her. But I continue to share the gospel. And at the end of the presentation of the gospel, this young boy said, you know, my grandpa has been telling me about this for years. He died recently, but he recognized in that moment that he needed salvation. He said, yes, I want to receive salvation. Imagine if I hadn't shared the gospel with that boy that day. Would God have brought someone else to share the gospel? I'm convinced that God would, because God wants all people to be saved. He sends people all over the place to share his good news. God's word tells us that he desires all to come to the saving knowledge of who he is. So would God have brought someone else to this young boy? Yeah, I believe that he would. But I would have missed the blessing in that moment too. It was exciting to share the gospel with this young boy and to see him to come to faith in Jesus Christ. We are all called to share the gospel. Does that mean we're not going to be scared sometimes? No, sometimes we might be nervous. I tell you, almost every time I go out intentionally to a beach or to knock on doors, or even if it's someone on the street where God says, share the gospel with this person now, each time that the fear of man comes up a little bit sometimes. And sometimes fear comes in a little bit. Lord, is that actually you, or is it just my own brain saying that? We know the answer to that, right? Of course, God's telling us to share the gospel. He tells us in his word to do so. But I tell you, in that moment, it's exciting to see someone come to faith. Yes, there's times we'll be afraid. But that's what boldness is. It's overcoming our fear. It's courage. That's why God's word tells us to be bold. Well, the Apostle Paul, too, even asks different churches, as he writes different letters to different churches, often would say to churches, pray for me that I would be bold to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Boldness is overcoming our fear. So yes, we may have nerves, but the important part is to be obedient. Here's what preaching involves. Preaching the word of God involves words. Romans 10, verse 14 to 17 says, I've alluded to this verse already. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? How will they hear without a preacher? How will they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. However, they did not all heed the gospel news. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed or repented, believed our report? So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. A person can't be saved from their sins if they don't hear the gospel. That's why the Apostle Paul writes these words to the church in Rome, to preach the gospel. All of us preach the gospel. B, preaching involves gentleness. We are to preach the word of the gospel, but how we preach the gospel is important. reminded of a story of a child evangelist who was preaching before a group of kids, sharing the gospel, and he took up this doll and said, if you don't repent, this is what's going to happen to you, and began to torch the doll. Now, is that gentle? No. I think about it, if I was a little child and saw that, I'd probably be freaking out. How many of you now would actually be freaking out about that? I'm sure some of us would be still. Yeah, I didn't intend for you to raise your hands, but I see some of you raising your hands. Yeah. Some of us, even as adults, still would still be freaked out by that. Doesn't mean we can't talk about hell. We must, because that's the consequence of our sins. Doesn't mean we can't talk about sin. We must, because that's what Jesus saves us from. But how we do it is still important. With gentleness. 1 Peter 3:15. But sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make a defense to anyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you. So the Apostle Peter is telling us again, share the gospel when people ask of you. Be ready at any moment. Yet with gentleness. We are to proclaim God's word, the gospel, with gentleness. Not being argumentative, not being trying to cause and stir problems. There's a street preacher that I've seen on YouTube, and I'm not going to mention his name, but sometimes when I've watched some of his videos, he's been out there preaching hard, but sticking on the sin. Sometimes spending 20 minutes on the same sin. Does that become gentle? No. Again, yes, we must talk about sin and what sin is to define it, because a lot of people don't understand what sin really is. But 20 minutes on one sin? Or speaking with anger? Have you heard any of some of those street preachers? They call them blowhorn preachers, where they're shouting at people. Now, there's a difference between speaking loud enough for people to hear. There's a difference between that and shouting at people. Shouting at people is not what God wants. He wants us to be gentle. That doesn't mean we can't do open-air preaching. I've actually done open-air preaching. And yes, you have to project your voice, but there's, a difference between projecting your voice and shouting at people. Even in how we talk with a person. Sometimes some people are a little bit belligerent when we share the gospel, but it's still being gentle with our words, with our tone, what words we use. But also, preaching involves respect. I've just read to you a moment ago, 1 Peter 3:15. And again, in the last phrase of it, yet with gentleness and reverence. The NASB uses the term reverence. Other translations use the word respect. They mean the same thing. So we're supposed to be respectful in how we approach a person, is how we share the gospel. Why are we to do that? Well, if I came at you and spoke angrily at you, do you want to listen to me? Probably not at all. That's why you must speak with respect towards people. To be gentle in how we approach. After all, Scripture tells us too, mentions that it's His kindness that leads us to repentance. So preach the gospel, use the words of the gospel, but preach it with gentleness and respect. We are all called to do it in this way. Think of how many more people reach with the gospel if we speak in this way, using the words of the gospel, but with gentleness and respect. I dare say there'll be more people who will be willing to hear the gospel then. We are all called to preach the gospel, to share the good news of Jesus Christ, to all God puts into our path, whether it be a friend or a family or a neighbor, a peer, co-worker, a stranger. We are all called to share the gospel. As I say these words, I'm not saying that we need to go to force the situation. I find more often than not that actually God provides the situations always. I don't have to force the situation. God opens up the doors. It's more a matter of when God opens the door, I'm recognizing it and walking through that door to share the gospel. There may be times where we miss that door and recognize it after. That's okay. Learn from that lesson. I remember one time we had a salesman come knock at our door in Ross Haven. Or no, it wasn't at our door. We were on the side in our yard, came up to my wife and I and started to talk about security systems. And so he gave his presentation after he walked off to the next door neighbors. And after he left, I was like, oh, perfect opportunity. This guy's selling security, and we have eternal security in Christ. Could have been a perfect opportunity. So I'm waiting for another security guard to come, or a security salesman to knock on my door. Hasn't happened yet since, but I'm waiting for that day. God opens up the door always. So we've seen and learned this morning. We are called, all as Christians, to go and preach the gospel and to actually use the words of the gospel. There's a story of Fritz Kreisler, who was a famous violinist. He earned a fortune in his concerts and for his compositions, but he was a generous man and gave a lot of his money away. One day he discovered an ad about this exquisite violin, but he wasn't able to buy it. Didn't have the money. But finally he raised the money and went to the person who was selling it and said, hey, do you still have this violin for sale? I would like to purchase it. And the seller said, oh, I'm sorry, I actually just sold it to this person. So he got the contact information of the person and went to the person who owned it now and said, oh, would you happen to have this violin for sale? And the gentleman said, no, I couldn't pass with it. It's a beautiful instrument. I want it's part of my collection. I want to keep it. Kreisler started to walk away and then realized, well, why don't I ask if I could play it at least? So he turned around and asked the owner, can I just take a moment just to play it? I'd love to play it for a moment. The owner said, yeah, sure. It'd be great to hear the violin played. Kreisler started to play the violin. The owner of the violin had tears in his eyes because of the beautiful sound of the instrument. He was so stirred that he said to Kreisler, I have no right to keep that for myself. It's yours, Mr. Kreisler. Take it into the world and the people hear it. In a way, it's a picture of the gospel message for us. The gospel is a beautiful message. It's a message that Christ has given to us, has entrusted to us to share. So let us not keep it to ourselves. May we go and share the beautiful words of the gospel. I want to encourage us with 3 points of action this morning. The first is this: be open to the opportunities God gives you to evangelize. Again, I said before, you don't have to force it. God will give you the opportunities. But look for the opportunities God gives you and then take those opportunities. Second point of action is this: rest in the power of the Holy Spirit to preach the gospel. If you don't know how to share the gospel, yes, it's important to be trained in how to share the gospel, but rely on the Holy Spirit. He will give you the right words to say at the right time. I can't tell you how many times I've shared the gospel with people. And again, afterwards, because I'd like to evaluate myself a lot of times, I would say, think to myself, man, why didn't I say this or that? This would have been perfect to have said. And then God always reminds me that, no, I gave you the words to speak. God knows what the person needs to hear. Rely on the Holy Spirit. He will give you the words to speak. And the third point of action of challenge is to be bold. Boldness doesn't mean loud and obnoxious. It means courageous. What does courageous mean? It doesn't mean that you don't have fear. It means that you overcome the fear. So be bold. Overcome your fear and share the good news. When we think about our friends, our neighbors, our loved ones that don't know the gospel yet, they don't have received Christ as Lord and Savior yet, how much do we care for them? Do we want to see them in heaven someday? Then let us step out in faith. Step out and share the gospel. Remember, God has given you the power, the ability to share the gospel. Do you want to see those who are close to you, who are lost, become saved? Do you want to see our church grow? Then share the gospel in the opportunities that God gives you. And may we do that together as his church too. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for these words you've given to us. Part of this vision that you've given to us as a church to evangelize the lost. Lord, you have said that is how your church will grow, by the lost becoming saved. Lord, we pray that you'd use us in this regard too. Lord, we know that you're ready and willing and able to use us. So may we surrender to you and allow you to use us. Lord, may we overcome our fears and step out in faith, believing that you will and can use us. And Lord, may you bless us with the opportunity to see people come to faith. And Lord, as we'll talk about next week, Lord, may we not just stop there, but may we disciple them in their newfound faith. God, you are a wonderful God. Lord, you don't need us to share your good gospel message, but you've given us the privilege and the honor to do so. So Lord, may we be a light to our community. May we live and preach your gospel. For these things we pray in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. I invite you to stand as we pray the benediction as we close our time of worship together. And just a reminder too, we are having a fellowship time after this, so you are still welcome to join us. If you, even if you didn't bring food, come and join us anyway. You're welcome to join us. We're going to be heading to our home from here. If you don't know how to get there, I have directions written on how to get to our place. But you're welcome to join us as we fellowship together around food and fellowship together. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. We also pray, Lord God, that you cover us and protect us. May you guide us through the storms of this week. May you be at work in us and through us and around us. And bring us back next week rejoicing and sharing with each other the wonders that you've performed. Amen. God loves you, and go in peace.